Good day, this is Jim Pytel from Columbia Gorge Community College. This is Digital Electronics. This lecture is entitled Counters. The purpose of today's lecture is to give you a very brief overview of some of the general terminology which we'll be dealing with this particular unit. And we're going to go into each of these applications and configurations in specific detail later on. But right now, again, it's just the general terminology. The three things that I want to talk about are asynchronous counters, synchronous counters, and finite state machines, a closely related topic to counters. Counters, if you remember right, are popular application of sequential devices, and they're very commonly used inside computer and digital electronic systems, because what do those systems do? Well, they do repetitive, boring stuff very, very well over and over, and you need to be able to count its actions. An asynchronous counter, if you remember right, I went over in the applications of flip-flops and latches lecture in general terms. Let's go in a little bit more detail, but not too much. Okay, so what I've drawn here is an asynchronous counter. This is a 3-bit asynchronous counter. Why? Because there are 3 flip-flops. Notice how I've drawn those flip-flops here. I've given them some terminology. This one has J0, K0 inputs, and has Q0 and not Q0 outputs. The next stages has J1 inputs, K1 inputs, and outputs Q1 and not Q1. And again, keep with the terminology. What we're going to do, we have J2, K2 inputs, Q2, not Q2. Outputs for the last and final stage. Okay, so what we're doing is we're drawing this thing from LSB to MSB. That's exactly how this asynchronous counter works. My outputs are those individual stages outputs. For this particular one, the outputs are coming off the respective Q outputs. Okay, that is my outputs. What are my inputs? We'll look at them. Every single stage, J0, K0, J1, K1, J2, K2, they're all in toggle mode. Okay, and there should be a +5 volts right here. What does the toggle mode do? Toggle mode is any time, in this particular case, it's a positive edge. Anytime a positive edge happens, the flip-flop changes state. Which one, however, has the clock? There's only one of them. Okay, so an asynchronous counter, there is a single clock input to a single flip-flop. And notice that one's output is the next stage's input. And this one's output is the next stage's input. So it sounds like there's a rippling change through these. Okay, and that's exactly what these things are sometimes called, ripple counters. And as you might have guessed, if I have 3 stages, there's going to be 3 times the delay at that third stage. If I have 4 stages, I might induce more delay. 5 stages, more delay. And that's another characteristic inherent to an asynchronous counter. There are delays. As you add more of these things, you might potentially get these glitch states because of that delay propagation, the propagation delay. So again, what have I done here? I've just described in very general terms an asynchronous counter. It's got a single clock input to one of the stages. In this case, it is the LSB stage. Those next stages receives the previous stage's output as its clock input. All JK flip-flops in this particular case are in toggle mode. Compare and contrast to what we're going to talk about now, a synchronous counter. So here's my general diagram of a synchronous counter. Notice it's not complete because there are no inputs for the J's and K's. We'll come back to this in a little bit later when we get to the specifics of it. But the big thing I want you to see immediately is the clock signal. Notice the clock signal is being fed to every single sequential device. Whereas previously, asynchronous, there was a ripple, and you would expect a propagation delay to occur for those things later on in the most significant bit positions. The synchronous counter, everything's clocked together. Everything changes simultaneously. Everything changes in synchronization, hence the name synchronous. Notice again that first stage inputs have a 0. Next stages, let's go ahead and stick with that same color scheme. The next stages have a 1. The next stages have a 2. And if you want to add a 4th one on there, it would have a 3 on it. Okay, I'm just differentiating them. And again, we are going to go from LSB to MSB. Where are our outputs? In this one, it's the Q0 output, Q1 output, Q1 output, Q2 output. I have not put the J and K input logic yet. The reason why is we'll go into that in specifics. But right now, suffice to say, the J and K inputs for each stage are given logic to make this thing count. And when I say make it count, you may want it to count in an up sequence or a down sequence, or an odd sequence, or an even sequence, or no sequence at all. Okay, we'll talk about that in a little bit when we get to finite state machines. But the big thing to remember about the difference between an asynchronous counter and the synchronous counter is right there. The clock is being fed to every single sequential element in it. And when this thing changes state, it changes with reference to that clock all simultaneously. Okay, the next general thing I want to discuss before we begin this unit is this concept of finite state machines and state diagrams. A state diagram and finite state machines, just think about it, it's finite. There are a limited number of states this thing could be in. And if I wanted to create a 3-bit up counter, I can go from 000 all the way to 111. And then when it gets to 111, it's going to go back to 0. Okay, so it's going to recycle, because that's what's known as a recycle. Anytime it goes back to the beginning, counts from 0 to 7, recycles 0 to 7, and so on and so forth. A state diagram, all it is a visual indication of where this thing goes next. And this is in the most general terms. Okay, right now, a MOR machine. Okay, a MOR machine, it's a counter. If it's not dependent upon external inputs, it's only dependent on its present state. That's a MOR machine. I'll repeat that. A MOR machine, its next state is only dependent on its present state. Okay, so if it is presently in state 000 and I'm making a 027 up counter, where's it going to go? Well, the answer is if it's 0, it goes to 1. So our state diagram would look something like this. Next clock edge, go from 000, go to 1. If it's in 1 and the next clock edge comes along, where does it go? To 2. You guessed it. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and then it recycles back to 000. So that's a state diagram. All it is, it's a visual indicator of if it's in a certain state, it goes to the next state. If it's in that state, where does it go to from there? What would a 720 down counter look like? Well, very similar, except the arrows are pointing the other way. Okay, so there you go. There's a state diagram for a down counter. If it's in state 5, right here, and it's in down counting mode, it's going to go to state 4. And now that kind of brings this concept of mode. So there's a MOR machine where its next state is dependent only on its present state. There's also this thing called a Mealy machine, where its next state is dependent not only on its present state, but also some external input. Could you imagine creating a 3-bit up-down counter? Okay, so there's two directions this thing can go. Which direction it's choosing, it's dependent upon an external input. And in this particular example, there are only two possibilities, up or down. Okay, so how many binary bits do I need to represent that external input, up or down? The answer is 1, because if I give it a 0, it could go up. If I give it a 1, it could go down. So there is an external input, 0, up, 1, down. You can do the opposite if you want to. You can do 1's up, 0's down, doesn't matter. I'm just using this for an example. That external input, it's two choices, but it's a single bit position. It's a single bit that can be represented, those two possibilities, those unique possibilities. You cannot simultaneously be up or down. What you'll commonly see is the thing that gets a 0 has a slash over, active low, up D, slash D. So that single external input can be written this way. When it's a 0, go up. When it's a 1, go down. And what is that single external input? It's called not U, slash D. Go ahead and see if you can potentially think about how the state diagram might look like with an external input, meaning there are two choices. There are two ways out of these present states. If I'm in down mode and I'm in position 1, where do I go? I go to position 0. If I'm in position 1 and I'm in up mode, where do I go? It's position 2. Okay, so it looks like there are two choices now for it, two choices to exit these states. And our finite state machine has to represent those possibilities. So I'm going to go ahead and erase the finite state machine, our current state diagram, and go ahead and add some external input, in this case, not U slash D. For purposes of illustrating this, what I'm going to try to do is represent not U, or when it's 0 going up as red, and when it's going down as blue. I'm in state 1, present state 1. If I'm in down mode, I go this way. And if I'm in up mode, I go that way. It's that simple. Each state in this particular case should have two exits. And I have to kind of illustrate that fact here is not u slash d. In this particular case, it's going up. That's a zero. Not u slash d is one. It's going down. So those arrows, those transitions from the state, basically, this is a prerequisite. That external input is prerequisite for it to transition to the next state. Now I'm in state two, and let's say I'm still in up mode. Where do I go? Obviously to state three. What are the input conditions based on those external inputs for me to do that? Not u slash d is equal to zero, i.e. up mode. And I can do that for every single one of these finite states. And it's really kind of like I had previously, except now I've got to account for that external input. And there is a partial representation of the finite state machine only accounting for those cases where it's in up mode. And then let's go ahead and complete this finite state machine diagram where we're accounting for the down mode. Okay, there you go. And I know it looks like a mess, but really think about this. It's just a 3-bit counter. If it's in up mode, it goes from 000 to 1 to 2 to 3. It's following the red path. And if it's in down mode, and let's say it's in state 5, it's going to go from 5 to 4 to 3 to 2. It's following the blue path. And now the thing is, think about this, is if it's in up mode and it goes from 0 to 1 to 2 and suddenly someone switches it to down mode, what does it do? It goes to 1. Think of an application for this. Think of something going into, let's say, a parking garage. It's counting the number of cars that come into the garage. It's counting the cars that come out of the garage. Okay, and it's telling you, okay, is the parking garage full? It can fit 7 cars, let's say. First car comes in, our next state is 1. Second car comes in, our next state is 2. Third car comes in, our next state is 3. One car goes out, our next state is 2. Okay, so it's this neat application of these things, not limited to, and I know this simple example right here is just counting up and down. It's not necessarily even limited to sequential. Okay, we could potentially count in gray bit code. We could potentially be counting odd and even mode. Okay, there's all sorts of things that you could do with this. And we are not necessarily limited to just two transitions. Perhaps there's an enable. So there are times when you stay in a state. Okay, say for example, there is also an external input called enable. If enable is 1, the thing's working. If enable is 0, stay where you're at. Okay, so think about this. Here is E equals 0. If you are presently in state 000, and you're not enabled, you're going to stay in state 000. If you're enabled and in up mode, where are you going to go? You're going to follow the red. So it sounds like we're going to be able to add enable and not up slash D as an input. If I'm enabled and, so these things get incredibly complicated, but again, what are they? They're just maps to transition out of a state, to transition to a different state, to potentially stay in that state. Okay, so a finite state machine. All right, one last thing before I finish up this concept of counters. And everyone forgets this. They get locked into this nitinoid details of JK flip-flops and clocks and propagation delay, and they totally forget to see the forest because of all the trees. And the answer is what do counters do? The counter counts. People always forget that. Counters count. And you need to think about this in the terms of an oscilloscope. When you're displaying the numbers 0 through 15 in the case of a 4-bit counter, and let's say that's counting in up mode, what do they look like? Well, they're counting. They look just like the truth table. Imagine a 4-bit truth table with quadruple 0 at the beginning and quadruple 1 at the end. If I made digitized pulses of those zeros and ones, what would they look like on oscilloscope? Chances are that they'd look something like this. Okay, so here is a 4-bit up counter. And notice in this particular position right here, and we're going MSB to LSB, it's 0, 0, 0, 0. It's in up mode. What's it do? It counts to 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. I'll save you the exhausting details. It gets to state 1, 1, 1, 1, the maximum of its sequence, 0 through 15. What's it do? It recycles 0, 0, 0, 0. Think about it now. What would a down counter look like? What would a counter that counts from 0 to 9 look like? What would a counter look like that counts from 9 to 0? People always get lost in some of the details, but if you can remember that anytime these things are activated or enabled, be it a positive edge or a negative edge, what's it going to do? It's going to count. And you should be able to remember some of the binary concepts that we discussed in our unit 2 of our previous lecture. So let's go into the details of an asynchronous counter.